Good evening.
Good evening.
And welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. Now, this is a school, and it is not a church. And neither are we affiliated with any church or religious organization. This school is a non-profit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to proving the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of the eternal pattern, purpose, and plan operating through our turning unto this present day. Now, this school is a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kennelly, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. And we were incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States and some other foreign countries. The Ontario branch school was established in May of 1988. Now, in this school, we use and teach by the true and original names and titles for the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. Now, the true name for the Heavenly Father is Yahweh, has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It also been improperly substituted by God. And the true name for the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Now, Lord and God, they are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are Lords many and Gods many. We now know that each Lord must have a name, and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is a title that our Creator chose for Himself. Now, Jesus is a name, but Jesus is an erroneous name. A minor investigation, listen up, on your part, in a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters or letters in their alphabet that would produce the sound made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of our Heavenly Father and His Son. Now, Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Now, Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state is incomprehensible, inscrutable, and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh symbolized in this pure spirit state on this chart as a cloud. Now, Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize Himself, because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We draw this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the creation abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in his pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super corporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. And this shape and form can only be seen in a divine vision and understood in a divine revelation. Now, later on, the self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the airplane as Yahshua the Messiah. The world calls him Jesus Christ. Now, there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of his name and title can be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in the school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh Elohim led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses on top of Mount Sinai and showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. Now he instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and court roundabout. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. And we go forth in the school to prove that everything in the universe moves and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and absolutely nothing escapes this pattern. Now the 10 primary constitutional objectives or aims of this tour as follows. One is to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. Two is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religion, psychology, philosophy, modern, practical, and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstitions, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensation and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensation of time. And eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation of faith that was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. And ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man must be saved, save in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the newer state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan is speak the truth. Tonight we have a prayer by Dr. Samuel Salas. Our scripture lesson is Matthew 16 chapter. Our scripture reading, Dr. Kenway Kleinspit. God bless you. He's in the restroom.
Good evening, class. Thank you, Almighty Yahweh, for make us strong in the faith and make us coming, and also for the good things you pour into ourselves, all the blessings we receive, and especially for this having this teaching, which is so wonderful and open our understanding for know you. And we are so blessed. And I say all those things in your only son name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let's all say hallelujah.
Yeah. evening, class. Good to see you all here tonight. I'll be reading Matthew 16 in the Holy Name Bible, revised by A.B. Traina of the Scripture Research Association and reprinted by Yashua Promotions. The Pharisees also with the Sadducees came and tempting desired him that he would show them a sign from heaven. He answered and said unto them, when it is evening, you say it will be fair weather, for the sky is red. And in the morning, it will be fall weather today, for the sky is red and lowering. O, you hypocrites, you can discern the face of the sky, but can you not discern the signs of the times? A wicked and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign, and there shall no sign be given unto it, but the sign of the prophet Jonah. And he left them and departed. And when his disciples were come to the other side, they had forgotten to take bread. And then Yahshua said unto them, take heed and beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and of the Sadducees. And they reasoned among themselves, saying, it is we have taken no bread. Which when Yahshua perceived, he said unto them, O you of little faith, why reason you among yourselves, because you have brought no bread? Do you not yet understand, neither remember the 5 loaves of the 5,000, and how many baskets you took up? Neither the 7 loaves of the 4,000, and how many baskets you took up? How is it that you do not understand that I spake not to you concerning bread, but that you should beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and Sadducees? Then they understood that he bade them not beware of the leaven of bread, but of the doctrine of the Pharisees and of the Sadducees. When Yahshua came into the border of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And they said, some say that thou art John the Immerser, some Elijah, and others Jeremiah, or one of the other prophets. He saith unto them, but whom say you that I am? And Simon Peter answered and said, thou art the Messiah, the Son of the living Elohim. And Yahshua answered and said unto him, blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my assembly, and the gates of Sheol shall not prevail against it. And I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Then charged he his disciples that they should tell no man that he was Yahshua the Messiah. From that time forth began Yahshua to show unto his disciples how that he must go into Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and be raised again the third day. Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, be it far from thee, Rabbi, this shall not be unto thee. But he turned and said unto Peter, get thee behind me, adversary, thou art an offense unto me, for thou savorest not the things that be of Yahweh, but those that be of men. Then said Yahshua unto his disciples, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself, and take up his yoke, and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. For what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? For the Son of Man shall come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then he shall reward every man according to his works. Verily I say unto you, there be some standing here which shall not taste of death, till they see a vision of the Son of Man's coming kingdom in glory. That was Matthew 16. Let us all say,
Hallelujah. Okay, it's good to be here today. This is our Thursday night class. Our first speaker will be Dr. Joe Williams, the Dean of the Interior Branch School.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
It's always a pleasure and an honor to stand before the assembly of Yahshua Messiah and testify of some of the things that Yahweh allowed me to see and understand about this great teaching.
Actually, I'd rather you use the shorter one.
All right. Happy to see you out, Alex. I hope something is said here to spark your soul and want you to continue to study with us and learn something about Yahweh and his purpose. Now, there's a lot I have to say. I'm not sure if I'm going to get through it all. But our goal and our purpose is to wake you up, to introduce you to your Creator, as the founder said, as he really is and as he actually exists. And what I strive to try to get the people to see is to become conscious of the spirit that is in these physical bodies and realize and understand that Yahweh has always been where he said he would be, and that is within a man's consciousness. We've been made to believe and think that Yahweh is up above the sun, moon, and stars, or someplace far from us. Mm-hmm. The things we were taught as children, going to the Catholic Church, the Baptist Church, the Lutheran Church, you know, Islam, Krishna, Buddha. We've learned all these different religions, depending on what culture you were from.
Right. Voodoo in some places,
you see. But the point is, that became our reality. Now Yahweh saw fit, you see, to come down and manifest in a physical body and cloak himself in the veil as Yahshua the Messiah. And his purpose and his mission and his goal was to atone for mankind's sins, to wake him up and bring him out of darkness and reveal to the man who the Father really, really, truly is, but more so who you are. And we come down here to find out where we come from, talking about our origin, our start place, our beginning. We want to know what this creation is. How did it come about? You see, what's going to happen to me when I die? What is the soul of a man? What is the spirit of the man? What is it that the rabbi, the priest, and the gurus, you see, and the senseis are talking about? This we want to find out about. We want to eliminate the skepticism, the ignorance, and the superstition that has been perpetrated upon us.
Right.
In this present kingdom age, and in reality, from the beginning of time, if you will. We want to understand those things and put it in its proper perspective. And our founder, who had a divine vision and revelation direct from Yahweh, said this: don't believe me because I said it, but make me prove it to your satisfaction. And what we want to do is make sure we offer proof and evidence to support everything we say. And we want to use the tools that Yahweh has given us to come to that understanding. Now, we all walked in here with a Bible in our hand, you see, and we didn't know anything about a Bible when we was out in the world. And when we did read and study, we thought we knew. We found out we didn't know. Now, our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, who said he had divine vision and revelation direct from Yahweh, was what they call a bibliomaniac. They say he knew the Bible from cover to cover. You can read a scripture, and he can quote the one before it and the one below it, you see. And when he had this vision, you see, he was in the Church of God in Christ for some 15 years. And he also had the gift of healings. And I'm not preaching killing. I'm trying to show you that the same state and condition he was in is the same one you're in. And he ain't no different than any one of us, you see. And we're going to be puffing up and propping him up because we were in the same condition, state condition that he was in prior to him having his vision and his revelation. Nevertheless, Yahweh blacked him out because he had this question part in his mind. How is it that Yahweh gonna make everyone see the world or see him the same way? When you got Ku Klux Klans, you got the Muslims, you got the Hebrews, you got the Gentiles, you got all these different organizations and sects
that is operating on earth, different groups and cultures. How are we going to get them the same way? And Yahweh revealed to him this divine pattern. And when you have a pattern, it's a blueprint that you can use to go by. And we have to identify what the pattern is and how the pattern operates. You see, that's what we have to do. Now, if you remember in the scripture lesson, they were talking about the folks that forgot, the 12 that walked with him. He said, beware of the leaven. Mm-hmm. Well, they thought he was talking about some bread, like Roman meal bread or something like that, you see. But he was never talking about bread. He was using it as a parable, as a type of the shadow. You see, when he said beware of the bread, then he goes on to say beware of the doctrine. People who are elevated, puffed up, egotistical, you see, focused on themselves, focused on their image,
right.
You see, attracted to the flesh, you see, that's what we're after. Now, this is something that I want to bring out that the Apostle Paul said after he was converted. And that is in this present kingdom age. So for the benefit of our new one, let me say this. This is called a chronology chart. You see? And what it talks about is the ages and dispensations and the divine order of affairs of Yahweh. There are seven ages. There are seven dispensations. What is an age? An age is the same or synonymous as the word world. So there's seven worlds, you see, and there's seven dispensations. You with me so far? So an age or a world is approximately 2,000 years. You see, this is called the antediluvian age. The word diluvian means flood, anti means before. So this is the age before the flood, which started from the fall of Adam and ended with Noah, which we talked about the other day. Had extensive talk about Noah, you see.
Right.
And then Noah and his crew, who was in the ark, passed from death unto life. For those who were not in the ark, of course, they died. And those who are in the ark, of course, they moved on to the next age. Post means after. So this is the age after the flood, you see, which ended at the cross, after Yahshua's death, burial, and resurrection. You see? And this is the present kingdom age. This is where you're sitting at right now. You see, this is the age that the Apostle Paul was converted, and this is the age where the outpouring of the Holy Spirit was made manifest, or where it was dispensed, whereby now you and I can understand something about our Creator, you see, as He really is, and as He actually exists, and for an assurity, whereby we're not guessing and speculating who God is, where He is, and how He's functioning, and how He's operating, that is, in the world and in the man. That's what's happening right here. So what we're doing, we're going way back into the realm of eternity, all the way back here. And we're looking at these invisible principles, and it was brought out by the moderator that Yahweh is spirit. You see, he's incomprehensible, inscrutable, and indiscernible to the natural senses. We're going way back up here, we're looking at these invisible principles. We see how the Father took on a shape and form as a spirit embodiment of a man, as Elohim, who is the archetype or the original pattern of the universe. How he transformed, talking about Yahweh Elohim, into this threefold, completely furnished tabernacle, and manifest means to make known. So this invisible spirit embodiment, or this super incorporeal anthropomorphic being, manifest, you see, or transform into this tabernacle, and then manifest as every cosmographical structure of the universe, that is, including you. You see, he showed the man Moses how he formed the man from the dust of the earth, you see, and how he brought that purpose right on down and put it right in your lap. And that's what we're going to try to do. Now, Hebrews 1 and 1, and also Hebrews 8 and 1. Now, the moderator already brought out that Yahweh is spirit. Then the question is, what is spirit? Spirit is divine intelligence, wisdom, knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, and strength. That is what spirit is. These principles are nine divine attributes that Yahweh chose to carry out his purpose. You see? And listen, everyone in the universe, every man that's manifested on the earth, have in his body intelligence, wisdom, knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, and strength. If you're in this room and you don't have these attributes in you, then you're excused from this talk. We ain't talking to you. But this is Yahweh's divine makeup. Mm-hmm. You see, Yahweh being spirit is both masculine and feminine within himself. He does not have to go outside himself to create or to procreate. He is equipped within himself to do just that. And it was Yahweh who gave birth to his son, you see, which is Yahweh Elohim, or Yahweh as Elohim, who is the original archetype pattern of the universe. You see, and we're trying to understand this spirit form, which is the Son of Yahweh. And as the book says, the only begotten Son. All right? Now let's read.
Hebrews 1:1,
please.
Elohim, who at sundries times and in various manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets.
I'll take 1 and 2, please. Go ahead.
Hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son.
Now listen, Elohim at sundry time and in various manners, you see, has spoken to us in these last days by his Son. Right. This is the last day. Mm-hmm. Everything with Yahweh is right now. Mm-hmm. But this is the last day. Right now. You see, talking about Elohim. Read on, please.
Whom he has appointed heir of all things.
Now look, Yahweh has appointed Yahweh Elohim heir, not of some things, but of all things, including you. Talk about him. Now listen, I want to get this understood. There is, the Father is not over here and his Son over there.
Right.
That's how it looks and that's how it sounds. This is a picture illustration of Moses' vision drawn out. It'd be the same thing if you had, any one of you had a vision right now, I mean was dreaming about what's going on in this room. You're the one man and you can actually tell everybody in that dream when you explain it, Bud's over there, Siobhan's on the other side, you follow me? Listen, on the north side, he's on the south side, we got two readers, you get what I'm saying? It can describe the color of the room and how the charts are assembled in the room. You see, that one man, all that goes on within your consciousness, and also, you can probably tell what everybody's thinking while you're yet in that dream. And I'm trying to get you to see that's what's happening with Moses here. It's not Yahweh Elohim over here, and the spirit is over here. This is all going on with this Moses when he was caught up in the realm of eternity. And he's explaining what he sees, you see, to the people. So he's showing you how that Yahweh, I'll say like this, everything in the universe is immersed or inundated, you see, within the pure spirit state of Yahweh, which are these attributes. And there's more attributes than the nine we have here. These are just a nine principal attributes that Yahweh chose to carry out his purpose. But there is a multiplicity of attributes encountered within any one attribute, if you will. Nevertheless, these attributes, you see, is Yahweh's makeup and is what spirit is. Now, if Yahweh is spirit, and he is, then his byproducts have to be that of himself.
Right.
Understand this. It's the one spirit. Oh, there's so much. In two manifestations. Incorporeal, meaning invisible, and visible. Invisible and visible. Incorporeal and corporeal. Mm-hmm. Talking about the one spirit. The example of that would be water. You see? It's a gas. It has humidity. What is humidity? It's water vapor held in the air at a given temperature. That's what humidity is. There's humidity in this room. Mm-hmm. Go to Texas, you really know what humidity is. Mm-hmm. And Ohio. You just be sweating like a dog on a pig. Mm-hmm. All day long because it's so humid. You see, but when Yahweh moved or took on shape and form, you see, this is an organized. This is the sun. which is no more than an organized set of attributes. And you got to get this understood, which is a spirit embodiment. Do you understand? A spirit embodiment. The arrangement of those attributes is his body. And it's made up of the divine attributes, which is spirit. And which encounters within his body, you see, is what? The angelic hosts. The angelic hosts, or the spiritual realm, the angels, whatever you want to call them, they encounter within that body, and also the physical creation. Mm-hmm. Now, your physical body is a witness to Yahweh Elohim, in that you have an inner man, but you also have an outer man. And when one moves, the other will move. But believe me, it's your inner man that's dictating when this physical body moves. Your physical body does not move because it just feels like it.
Right.
It is all dictated, of course, by the inner man, or the angelic, or that immortal spirit that is housed in your physical body. You see? Now, so this is Elohim expressed. This is him and one spirit embodiment. But when you look at him, you can't see what you don't understand him in his spirit embodiment or in his super incorporeal state and condition. You don't understand him. So he breaks himself down. He transforms into this tabernacle, having a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. This one is covered over. This one here is exposed. Most holy place, court round about. These vessels, or these articles that's in your pattern, is a reflection of Yahweh himself. Why? Because Yahweh is the pattern personified. What do you mean by that? What is the pattern? The pattern in simplicity is this, simple. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Do you get that? In an abstract state. Let me say that one more time. The pattern is the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. That is in the abstract state, or in Yahweh's ontological state of perfection. That is, if you will, in this state, in his condition. But you cannot see him in his pure spirit state. Why? He's incomprehensible. What do you mean? You can't understand him. He's inscrutable. What do you mean? You can't put him in a test tube and look at it and examine him. He's indiscernible. He has no shape or form in this state condition, just like the air. You don't see no shape or form in the air? Yahweh is likened, I'll say it like this, the air is likened to pure spirit. It has no particular or descriptive shape or form. That's why Yahweh chose a cloud, listen, to symbolize himself, because a cloud, as you see it, has no particular or descriptive shape or form. Sometimes it looks like a bear, sometimes it looks like an elephant, sometimes it looks like a fish, sometimes it looks like a man. You understand?
Right.
Because Yahweh says, I'll be what I will to be.
Right.
Including you. You see? So when we get these myths out of the way, this is Yahweh, pure spirit. So now he's taking on shape or form. You see? And let me say it like this. It was in the cloud, or in the realm of eternity, whereby Yahweh declared what shall be, which we'll draw that out in a minute. You see? But first, he created his only begotten Son. He gave birth to his only begotten Son, or he fathered the shape of form, or his Son. This is Elohim, or it is Yahweh Elohim, talking about the shape and form. Nevertheless, when Yahweh, I'll say it like this, when Yahweh Elohim, or when the Son, come from behind the veil of inscrutability and incomprehensibility, he's appearing within the cloud, within Moses' consciousness. And it is Yahweh Elohim himself who's going to also appear to you within your consciousness. Now look, please. Let's just get this understood. Don't be looking for no man to show up in your head. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Yahweh chose a man, a spirit and body of a man, because he was dealing with the carnal mind. What is the carnal mind? One that does not understand spiritual principles. Simple. A carnal mind has theory. theories, concepts, and opinions. What you think, what you create in your imagination. That becomes reality. If I was an adopted child, you told me you were my parents, and I'm going to believe it. It's a lie. You're not my biological parents, but you are my parents. Mm-hmm. Now, when I grow up and get all cocky, and I find out you're not my parents, now I'm mad. But they took care of me, they nurtured me, they disciplined me. You get what I'm saying? They gave me a good life, and because you're not the ones, I'm mad about it. That's carnal. And that's corrupt. Unappreciative, because it's not your way and what you want and what you feel and what you believe. Do you understand what I'm saying? You see, that's what we call, listen, the egotistical misdirected personality. And I'm letting you know, we all have that, and some of us still do. And what they want to do is come in here and judge us with their earthly concept. Don't know nothing about Yahweh, never heard about Yahweh, and I'll say it like this. Don't know nothing about God, don't know where he is, can't describe him, just believe that he is. In your imagination, based on your earthly concept. Now that's carnal and corrupt. Why? Because you believe it. Now, you got to play with folks' minds. Tickling, if you will. I may not be your biological father, but I love you. And I'm going to take care of you. And no matter how you feel, I'm going to still be there for you. And when you get through being mad, I'm going to still be your mother.
Yeah.
And he's going to still be your father. We're going to move forward.
Right.
That's supposed to make you feel better. Satisfying your flesh.
Right.
Do you understand what I'm saying?
Right.
Oh man, so much. Keep reading. Come on, I ain't gonna run out of my time. Read, please.
By whom also he has ordained the ages.
In other words, he ordained or he framed the ages. What are you talking about? Remember, we got seven ages and seven dispensations. A dispensation is a divine ordering of affairs. You see? So therefore, you got the dispensation of Adam, you got the dispensation of Noah, the dispensation of Abraham. You understand what I'm saying? It's a divine order of affairs. Yahweh is drawn up, that is, through the man. You see? So, when you see here from the fall of Adam, see how we are. You see that line? You see this line right here? You see that line? You see that line? We got a line here that makes this almost like a window, right? You see, a line here that's almost like a window. Like you framing a window. Mm-hmm. So we're framing an age. Mm-hmm. King James says the worlds were framed. You see? Ordained. Either one, but frame is more apt because you're framing it by the man. Walking down through the age and dispensation. But here, from the fall of Adam, the man was in darkness. Because we all took on Adam's sin, which is what I'm trying to get to. You see? And listen, we go to church, be turning flips. You know how we be dancing and carrying on, singing out loud, sweating all over the place. You see? Throwing our wigs all around. You see? All the writers don't exist. You see? When the Holy Spirit moving you. You follow me? And you want to give away all your money at that moment. You see, until you realize what you did.
Yeah.
You know what I'm talking about. But the point is, what I'm trying to get you to see, the man walked in darkness from the fall of Adam all the way down to the cross, where Yahweh poured out his spirit in the hearts and mind of men, and now the light is now shining in darkness. In you. And you find out there is a spirit that's operating in you, but it's been going on all along.
Right. Yeah.
That's what I'm trying to get you to see. You see, nevertheless, my point is, from the fall of Adam all the way down to the cross, you see, man walked in darkness. Now, the Holy Spirit has been poured out in this age. What do you mean the Holy Spirit been poured out? You have an opportunity to know your Creator and have an understanding of him, or it is now made manifest because the covers are taken off.
Right.
You know good and well you didn't know what no spirit was.
Right.
You didn't know intelligence is spirit. Can you see love with your natural physical eyes? No. You see the manifestation of love, how a mother takes care of a child, how the animals will fight and defend their young. You see, you'll fight, defend your family. Somebody can walk through the door, ain't got no business up in there. You're gonna discuss, hey, what you doing up in here. You might shoot him or bop him in the head with a bat or something like that. Cause he ain't had no business. He didn't knock on the door, he didn't ring the doorbell, he come climbing through the window. He deserves a knock in the head. Do you understand what I'm saying? And you are just. And if you kill him, it's okay. Why? It ain't murder. The book says thou shalt not murder, not kill. It's different than killing somebody, defending yourself, and murder somebody for money. You get my point?
Yeah.
And let me say something. There ain't nothing wrong with money. It's the love of money. What you will do for the money. How you change your mind for the money. Or think about it when the money's involved. That's the problem.
Yeah.
You get my point?
Mm-hmm.
Because money's involved, it ain't nothing but paper. But you kill for it. You get the point I'm trying to say?
Yes.
We all like that. You see? Why? Our minds are corrupt looking at the flesh. Do you get what I'm saying? That's what I'm trying to get you to see.
Yeah.
Now, I didn't mean to get into that. Getting back to this. This spirit man is the boss himself. These attributes are arranged in such a way that you might understand him. Now, we have these attributes painted on the chart, right? But do you see attributes in the sky written someplace? You get the point I'm trying to make? And do you see it?
No.
You see these lines we have drawn here? Do you see lines drawn down and down on the earth plane? You follow what I'm saying?
Right.
We understand now this imaginary line, we call them, talking about the earth, longitude, right?
Right.
We understand that through math. Isn't that right? We understand that. That the earth is like a grade. Just like this altar right here, it had a grade on it.
Yeah.
You see, and there's four corners to this altar because there's four corners of the altar points to the earth.
Because
mm-hmm. there are four pulls of gravity on the earth. You see, and you put a sacrifice on that altar. You see, and I tell you something about these doggone Christians who think they know so much. They don't know what it is they believe until they come down here or they talk to somebody who understands. They have no idea what the first covenant or the first testament was. When you violate one of those laws, I'm talking about the 613 statute, judgments, and ordinances, you should die, but instead they put up an animal, an innocent animal. We brought this out the other day.
Right.
Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. And that animal had to die for you, you see, for another year. Because your sins had to be forgiven. And let me tell you something, I ain't gonna get into that. I will say this. When Yahweh stepped out of the cloud or appeared within the cloud, that was the sacrifice right there. When he took on shape and form, the true crucifix was right here. Because he didn't have to do that for you.
Right.
He came down manifest in a body so you can see who he really is and how he's operating. That is in the realm of eternity. But he didn't have to do that. But out of love for you, Yahweh came, took on shape and form. And then manifest as the creation. So you have something to look at, and he himself is a representation or a manifestation of the pattern. It started here, the Father, Son, the Holy Spirit, and then he took on a shape and form as Yahweh Elohim, as Joshua, in one embodiment. Made you with a head, chest, and abdominal region, but you have one body, or you function as one unit.
Right.
To get you to see that you are made in his likeness and in his image. That's what it's all about. You waking up. Coming out of darkness. Mm-hmm. Nevertheless, here he is, and he manifested, listen, as chaosis, the darkness.
Mm-hmm.
So Yahweh is not chaotic. He just appears to be chaotic. And then he transformed into the first day, separating the light from the darkness, the twilight, and the mist. You see? Second day, the waters above and the water beneath with the firmament, the mist. Third day, the waters rolling off the face of the deep, the dry land appeared, and the seed of vegetation is coming on forth. Into the bud state, into fruition. Vegetation. You see how these charts are separated, showing by 1, 2, 3? Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, and one body. One day, 2 days, 3 days. But it's threefold. Do you understand? 4 days. He put the seas in positions. The stars and moon stars in position. You see? But it is threefold. Likewise here. Birds in the heaven, fish in the sea, and animals that cohabitate on land and water. You see? But it's threefold. Witnessed to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And then he makes the man. Don't look like it, but he is made spirit, soul, and body. That's the make of the man. Why? Because he is spirit. He housed the souls of souls. You see? And the body is the arrangement of those attributes. And the entire purpose and plan is encountered within that body right there. You see? And it's this spirit man, getting back to my point, Yahweh appeared to Dr. Kinley as a man. He appeared to Moses as a man. Do you get my point? Mm-hmm. Because it's familiar. You see? And he talked to the man, and the founder said it like this. Yahweh appeared to him that way because he knew he would not appreciate the brightness of his wisdom. Mm-hmm. You see? But if I took all these hearts off of here, you have no clue what this is. Mm-hmm. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Right.
And since you living and walking in the creation that Yahweh created, you still don't know what it is. Mm-hmm. Until Yahweh Elohim in you reveal to you within your consciousness what the creation is and who he is and where he is and how he's functioning in you. Mm-hmm. And just maybe you'll get it.
Yeah.
But you don't want to go to flesh. Flesh feel good now. Everybody likes the flesh.
Yeah.
And I do mean everybody. You see? Nevertheless, you got to find out what's operating in you. Now, get the Hebrews, because I can't mess up my time. I'm messing up right now. Read, please.
You mean go to 8?
Where you are, no. Where you are in Hebrews, finish that up.
Who
go
start the again.
Just start again. Hurry up. Read.
Elohim, who at sundries time in various manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophet,
mm-hmm.
hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son.
So he's spoken to us by his Son. But the same one also spoke to the prophets. Now, let me say this. Because Alice is new. This is not the word. This Bible is the express revealed will of Yahweh. That's all it is. I'm not going to do it, but I can toss this Bible way over there and not think twice about it.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm not going to sit up here crying crocodile tears, praying, thinking that this is the word. Mm-hmm. This is a book. That's all it is a book. Ain't nothing holy about it. No. There's nothing holy about the book. And it already said, pick up John real quick and finish that reading when you left off. Go ahead. He's expressed the image, right?
Hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son.
Read.
Whom he has appointed heir of all things,
read.
By whom also he has ordained the ages, who being the brightness of his glory and the exact impress of his substance.
He's the exact impress of his substance. Read.
And upholding all things by the word of his power.
Read on.
When he had by himself purged our sins.
Now that's good enough right there. Now go over to John real quick.
John 1. In the beginning was the Word.
Now look, in the beginning was the Word. Read on.
And the Word was with Yahweh.
The Word was with Yahweh.
And the Word was Yahweh.
And the Word was Yahweh. Come on, read.
The same was in the beginning with Yahweh.
Look, the same Word was in the beginning with Yahweh. Let's read.
All things were made by him.
It didn't say some things were made by him. He said all. Now let's get one thing straight. All means all.
Right.
It don't mean some, it don't mean few, but it also means you too. Mm-hmm. All means all. All things was made by the shape and form of Yahweh himself.
Right.
Why? Because this is Yahweh in his creative state. You see, Eya Asher Eya. You see? And his eye will be stayed. Because see, keep this in mind. This is likened to the cloud. You see, in this state and in this condition, which is the abstract state, this is where pure creativity takes place. Infinite possibility and pure potentiality is in this state. There's only one spirit. We think there's more than one. You know, we say, what about the devil? What about the devil? What about his spirit? I'm gonna get that in a second. Read, please.
And without him was not anything made that was made.
Without Yahweh appearing within the cloud of coming from behind the veil of inscrutability and incomprehensibility, was this would not even be here. Because Yahweh gave birth to his son and then he went back into his rest. Oh, yes, somebody. And then, you see, Moses witnessed how the creation came in by the pattern. Moses was not in the beginning. He just caught him up in a vision and showed him how it happened. Because Moses was here and Yahweh took him back. The same thing we're doing to you. We're taking you back and showing you a vision of Elohim to Moses. Just as the founder had a vision of Elohim, you see, to Ezekiel. John had a vision of Elohim to John. So we're taking you back and showing you the same exact identical vision. Right. So that you can understand what Moses was looking at, what John was looking at, what the founder was looking at, and what anybody trying to explain a principle is looking at. Mm-hmm. We got a pattern that we're operating by. Read, please.
In him was life, and the life was the light of men.
Now listen, he says, in him was life, and the life was the light of men. In other words, it was this spirit that took up residence in Adam and illuminated his consciousness. Talking about the shape and form. And get this straight. When this shape and form took up residence in Adam, that was Yahweh made manifest.
Right.
When that spirit took up residence in you, Alex, that is Yahweh made manifest in the personality of Alex.
Right.
But because you don't know, you're in darkness, you're in ignorance. When you get here, you don't know what this is, and frankly, you don't even care.
Right.
And one day you find out you exist. When that happens, I don't know. That's when you really think you're something. You put that flesh on, boy, and I mean, you think you own the doggone world. You know what I mean? You walk up to your parents after the dog falls, screaming and hollering, give me my Bible. That's a translation for that. The holler, whatever you're saying. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? You know what's so funny to me? I love to see babies who can't talk, man. And they be saying all kinds of stuff. I just wish I could translate that. They be chocolate. I say, oh, I know they're cussing me out, you know what I mean? Because not only they can't articulate the words, and sometimes they be saying some of the words you be saying, you know what I mean? But I sure wish I could translate it, but I get the point.
Yeah.
You get the point I'm trying to make? Now, the word was made flesh.
And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not.
Now he's the light. Your physical body, or that spirit, or what you think about the light. I said, what you think about the light is the darkness. Your knowledge of the world is the darkness.
Okay.
Your knowledge of him is the light. Mm-hmm. And that you don't know that he's in you as you. He is the light that's causing your heart to beat. He is the light that's causing your lungs to pump or to have inspiration, respiration, inspiration, and expiration. You see, it is him in you that's causing your digestive system to function. It is him that's in you that's causing your excretory system to function, where the cleansing of the blood takes place within your kidneys. Do you understand what I'm saying? It is him within you that's regulating, you see, your pituitary gland, which is the master gland of the body. You see, where there's 10 hormones on one side and 3 on the other side. Do you understand what I'm saying? But it's spirit law that is governing this body, just like it's spirit law that is governing this body. You have to see that when Yahweh took on shape and form, and he took on residence in Adam, or manifested in Adam, can't you see that heaven is now on earth, or the kingdom is now on earth? Got to bring heaven down and locate Yahweh in the body. This might be you. Now, we may say, well,
ain't Yahweh. What the heck are you talking about? I don't look like Yahweh.
I wanna know what you really look like in the first place, as far as you're concerned. How you know what Yahweh look like?
Really?
Like you know it.
Really?
And you say, well, I just know he don't look like me. Why not you?
Really?
Now,
14
verse.
And the light, and the word was made flesh and dwelt among us.
And the word was made flesh, or the word was made flesh and dwelt among us. Alright? Read.
And we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth.
Now, Ephesians. And then I want Hebrews 8:1. I spent too much time on that. Read.
Ephesians what?
4:4.
Ephesians 4:4.
Read.
There is one body and one spirit.
Now hold it right there. Alex, don't read over this. There is one body, and this is it. I know y'all think all these bodies mean something, right? And y'all, we don't count. It's just his.
Right.
And it's not, if it's not his spirit in you, then I'm not sure what is. Now, if there's one body, within that one body, are your children, their children, and their children right where you sit. Your children, their children, and their children right where you sit. In him is the whole house of the human race. It's the whole house of the animal kingdom. It's the whole house of the angelic host. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's within him. Because everything abides within him. And there's nothing outside of him. Because there's nothing that precedes Yahweh. Or that is pre-existent of Yahweh. Why? He's the ultimate source. The immaculate substance. The limits, the bounds, the origin, and the essence of everything in existence. That's what Yahweh means. He who causes to exist. If it exists, it exists by the will of Yahweh.
Right, right.
Not you and what you think and what you feel. Because he's the ultimate source. What do you mean? He's the beginning. He's the start place. He's the origin. Talk about him. All right? Now, keep reading Hebrews.
Hebrews 8:1. Now the things which we have spoken.
Hold on. I apologize. I mean Ephesians. Let me get off my track here. There's one body and one spirit. There's one body. It didn't say two spirits.
No.
Not three spirits. It said there's one body and one spirit. Now the question is, where's the devil? Somebody, like he got his own spirit. You get the point I'm trying to make? Where did his spirit come from? If Yahweh is the source and substance, not of some things, but all things.
Right.
You with me so far? Because Yahweh created the devil. Somebody say, what? Yeah, he created the devil.
Yeah.
And the founder said it like this. The devil, or the adversary, he's an asset, but not a liability. You know what he said?
That's what he said.
He's not a liability, but he's an asset. Now, you know, if you didn't understand good and evil, you would never appreciate good. Mm-hmm. If that's all you saw. But if you always saw bad, then maybe you can appreciate good. But if bad is all exists, that's what you're going to be. Because that's the way of the world. You get my point?
Mm-hmm.
Read, please.
Even as ye are called in one hope of your calling.
Go ahead.
One Elohim.
Hold it. One Elohim. Not a bunch. Not 2-3. Not 4-5. One Elohim.
Right.
Watch this. Read.
One faith.
One faith. Now hold on. You know how we are. What faith you belong to? Oh, I'm Baptist. Oh, I'm Seventh-day Adventist. Oh, I'm Jehovah's Witness. I'm Mormon. The founder says this. You don't even know how to ask. You don't even know how to ask an intelligent question. There ain't but one faith. That's him. That's Yahshua Messiah. Now, where all these faiths come from, I don't know. There's one faith, and that's him. And if you don't see him, you know how we are. We made to believe a lie. I'm going to prove that for you tonight. If I don't do nothing else tonight.
Mm.
That should go home and tell your whole family.
and your neighbors too, and your friends, that Jesus is not the name of the Son of God. That's what I'm proving tonight before I go. When you leave here tonight, you're going to know that Jesus is not the name of your Creator or the Holy Spirit or whatever you want to call him. I'm going to straighten that out in a few minutes. One Spirit, one body, one faith. Read.
And one baptism.
One baptism or one immersion. Read.
One is Yahweh.
One is Yahweh.
And Father of all.
Mm-hmm.
Who is above all,
mm-hmm.
and through all,
mm-hmm.
and in you all.
Now, I didn't say that. That's what the book says.
That's right. True, dear.
Through all, above all, through all, and in you all. Now, this is my question. Where did you come from? Where did you come from? It is him that through all, above all, and through you all. Where are you? Where I'm talking about is you and Yahweh and that body. And then get mad at me because I told you about it. You ought to be happy, I told you.
I
understand that. Something else. This thing you call a you is your carnality.
Right.
Your morals. And your wishy-washy mind.
Mm.
You know, like Trump say, he's flipping on me. He flips all he wants. But when you flip on him, he got a problem.
Right.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? You want me to forgive you, but you can't forgive me. You want to talk about big dog, but when I throw rocks back at you, you know what I mean? You know what I'm talking about? Some people love to chunk rocks. They just don't want you chunking back.
Right.
It's like the guy over at the ER. He say, they come and bring some of them gang members in there, you know, and say, hey, listen. The thing about the gang members, they run around with their gun. They like shooting, you know, drive-bys and all that. They just don't want nobody shooting back at them. They over there, we shoot right back at them. You get my point? They don't want nobody shooting back at them. You want like chunking rocks on you. You want to hear everything. You want to get everything off your chest, what your likes and dislikes are, but you don't want to hear my position
right.
on it either.
Right.
So we can have a conversation because you can't listen.
Mm-hmm.
When I say you, I'm talking about your egotistical, misdirected personality can't listen because your mind is corrupt because it's all about me, myself, and I. And we're trying to destroy that or wake you up and understand it ain't about what you think, what you feel, and what you believe. It's all about him and what is.
Right.
Y'all with me so far? Now, remember, carnality, to be carnal-minded, is death. To be spiritual-minded is life and peace. Changeable or mutable, if you will. Immutable is unchangeable. Righteousness, what is that? Righteousness means to be without sin, without fault.
The nice thing about in this room, everybody got fault. I'm the first one, and everybody out there, and everybody walking on the earth, they all got fault.
That's right.
They all have sin. Mm-hmm. They all have lied. We all have.
Yes.
We all have fault. We all got problems. Yahshua, he ain't got no problems. Just look like it. When he put him on the cross, he expected that. He set that up.
Yeah, right.
And not only that, he made him do it. I'm going to prove that in a minute if I can. You see, my point is, you see, we think the physical body is flesh. I'm talking about this thing right here. We think this is flesh. You can't see flesh. Why? Flesh is sight, touch, sound, taste, and smell. Can you see them? Can you see smell, Doc?
No.
Can you see taste? Can you see sound? Can you see touch? Can you see sight? No, but it makes you act a fool.
Yeah, yeah.
Especially when you get the reckless eyeballing, checking something out, you ain't got no business.
Yeah.
And don't once you get too close, you smell mighty good. What perfume is that?
Yeah.
Oh, he sure got some nice big muscles. You follow me? And in your mind, you can just feel them. Let me touch. Look, you get my point? That's what we do. It's entertained within our consciousness. We look at TV and we see a nice burger. Oh my God. Let's go get one of those. You get my point?
Yeah.
Yahweh have set this thing up and the adversary, Lucifer, he takes something physical to trick you with something spiritual. Which is what I'm after. But the point is, this is you that you created. And I'm letting you know this. Yahweh does not want any parts of it. Not a part of it. No parts of it. Whatever you think you are.
And some of them, you just think, we so proud. You follow what I'm saying? You get my point?
So proud! But you can't help somebody who need. You get my point? You get the point I'm trying to make? This one here, he helped everybody in need. This one here helped everybody in need. Didn't think twice about it. It's only flesh. You see what I'm saying? Now, one more. I got time for that. 1 Corinthians 3:16. And then I'll get into what I really want to talk about.
1 Corinthians 3:16.
Now this is Paul.
No, you're not.
Hold on. I apologize. Okay, that's it. Here's Paul in his age. He was just like me and you. Paul, he believed in the law. You know what I mean by the law? He believed in this Mosaic law. Just like your mom and your grandparents and all them, and your priest and your rabbi too. Want to tell you all about what the Bible says, and then they go out and do their dirt. Y'all know about the Catholic Church being exposed right now, am I right?
Right, yes.
And you know what? Yeah. They're not mad at the people. You know who they're mad at? They're not even mad at the priest so much. You know who they're mad at? The doggone bishops. The bishops who saw it and covered it up.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Saying, hey, I understand you got a problem, but I'm going to take you out of here. I'm going to put you over here. Now, you be good. Slap his hand. You be good. Because you know what I know. I got my eyes on you. But he's on another doggone side of doggone country. Mm-hmm. But he's a bishop. And you know what? He gets you in confession. And we like a fool. Tell me your sins. Bless you, my son. Tell me your sins, right? And you say, you know, I got these feelings. I don't like it, but I got these feelings. Now he know who you are. And he says, oh, I got me one. Mm-hmm. Instead of, and look, move you, give you a nice little uniform. And you feel so good, you got your new little uniform on, and you lead the dog on, you get my point? The pomp and circumstances. You just so proud of yourself. Father so-and-so gave me a position. And he rubbing your head, patting you on the shoulder, and every now and then just pat you on the back, pop you up, you get my point? And you feeling mighty good because Father so-and-so has given you a position. And next thing you know, he's walking with his arms around you. You say, rubbing your head. You know, you get my point? And you think he just loved you to death? And he's setting you up. That's what's wrong. That's the deception. And you don't even see it coming.
Yeah.
And then, he do what he does, and guess what happens? You don't want to expose Father so-and-so. Because he gave you your position. And you don't want to lose your position because you don't want to make Father so-and-so. Can't tell because he's going to mess up the church.
Yeah.
Because he messes that. You know, we can't talk about this. I'm going to go and I'm going to save my sins. You get my point? And it's just a cycle. You get the point I'm trying to make. And I'm trying to get you to see it's just flesh. That's all it is.
Right.
Now, I want to get this out before we move on. Because I got to get up in that garden. That's where I'm headed to. And I ain't going to waste our time. This one's for you. John 19:19. All right? Now, this is Jesus. I'll say it like this. Our new visitors, we got to make sure we feed them. And let them know. That's why I appreciate what Doc did the other night. He said, hey, listen, this is what we're going to talk about tonight. Whatever you pull out of here, this is what we're going into, and we went into Noah. He know more about Noah than now than he had his entire life. All right? Now, this we talk about, here's Joshua. We read the scripture lesson, right? You got it?
Pick up John 19:19.
Yeah, but pick up the scripture lesson real quick. Stay where you are, Kinaway. Don't you go nowhere.
3 and jump down to, I think it's around about maybe 23, maybe 22. I say exactly what you say, what you tell me, you're going to die, you're going to be buried and resurrect the third day. It's in 16, around about. 16.
Oh, okay.
You find it? That's exactly where it is in just a second.
16 and 22.
16 and 22. That's, yeah, that's it.
Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying,
Hold on. I apologize. 20 on down to 21.
16:20. Then charged he his disciples,
yes,
they should tell no man that he was Yahshua the Messiah.
Read.
From that time forth began Yahshua to show unto his disciples,
uh-huh,
how that he must go into Jerusalem,
uh-huh,
and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed.
And be killed! He told them that. So they should expect it. Read.
And be raised again the third day.
And then he's going to raise again the third day. Now you know they didn't believe that. I mean, would you believe it? They didn't believe that. But he told them. But they didn't believe it. You get the point I'm trying to say? Why? Because they were carnal folks. There was nothing righteous in those folks. They had no clue who that was. As far as they're concerned, he's Joseph the Mary boy, just like any other boy who got parents. Although, they like rolling with him. He was healing the sick, called them blind to see, raising the dead. You get what I'm saying? Feed 5,000 people with 2 fishes and 5 loaves of bread. I mean, he was rolling with them. They like that. Called the dumb to speak and the deaf to hear. I'm rolling with him. But I don't believe he's going to raise from the dead. Do you get the point I'm trying to make? Because they were carnal. You see? And his name was not Jesus, just incidentally, for this very reason. One, he was a Hebrew. And the moderator said, there is no J or J character that is in the Hebrew language to this day, the Greek or the Latin.
Right.
So he couldn't be named Jesus. Secondly, you see, he was a Hebrew and not a Gentile. We all Gentiles, at least we look like it. We're not Hebrews in here.
Right.
All right? You see, so, read now. This is after he just said he's going to die. We just read that, right? Now he's getting ready to get put up on the cross. And this is what happens. Read.
Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him.
What are you reading now?
22.
John 19:19.
Now.
We've got to
and Pilate
wrote a title. See, when we read, we need to keep the purpose in mind. So if I'm talking about the name, you should know exactly where I'm going. You see? And what point I'm trying to make. And then you should know what's coming up because we talk about it every day. You get the point I'm trying to make? So what I'm trying to do now is prove that the name is not Yahshua. So we're going to go to Joshua.
Jesus.
I mean, your name is not Jesus. So we're going to go to John, where Yahshua talking to himself, you see, and Pilate wrote this inscription on the cross. Read.
And Pilate wrote a title and put it on the cross.
Now, Alex, this is it right here. You don't see no J up there now, do you? That's in every church who got this cross. And folks run around with a cross on their neck, it's on there too. Read!
And put it on the cross, and the writing was...
Now this is the writing, it's on the cross, let's read!
Yahshua of Nazareth,
uh-huh,
the King of the Jews.
Read!
This title then read many of the Jews.
Read.
For the place where Yahshua was crucified was nigh to the city.
Go ahead.
And it was written in Hebrew.
It was written. No J. Come on.
And in Greek.
No J.
And in Latin.
No J. To this day. So his name couldn't be Jesus on the cross. But you want to jump on me because I said ain't no doggone Jesus. Or Jehovah. Or James. Or John. John's real name is John Hannon. That's his real name. It was not Jerusalem, it's Jerusalem.
Right.
It's not Jeremiah, it's Jeremiah. You see, somebody said, well, if the J is so important, why do you change all the J's? Because there ain't no salvation in Jeremiah, or James, or John. But there is salvation in Yahshua. That's why those ones is in there like that. And that's why it ain't no salvation. Whoops, sorry. And ain't see Kelly either. How about that? And we ain't gonna
insert his name in the Bible. He's in the Bible, but we ain't gonna set his name in there.
Right.
Because his name is already written in the Lamb's Book of Life.
Right.
You get the point I'm trying to make? Give him his props, give him his due, but we ain't saved in his name.
That's right.
But he was Yahweh made manifest. And so are you. He says, I'm Yahweh. The difference is I'm conscious of it and you're not. And I'm endeavoring to bring you up to that understanding. So what we're doing, we're trying to cast out demons, you see. But you got to walk with demons to understand demons. Now, this is what I'm talking about. John 70 and 6. I love going to this part right here.
There's no 70.
6 and 70.
6 and 70.
Swap it, yeah.
Yahshua answered them, have not I chosen you 12?
Uh-huh.
And one of you is the adversary?
Adversary takes the edge off of it. See, like Trump said, he called that girl a dog, right?
Right.
He said that dog. That's what he was really saying, though. You see, because everybody knows that a female dog, right, is a bitch.
Right.
That's a proper name. That's a proper term for a dog, female dogs. Mm-hmm. It's called a bitch. That's not a bad word, but people made it out of that.
Right.
Because of how they internalized it. But that's really what he was saying. Mm-hmm. But he couldn't say that. Tweet that. Because then it's a true representation of, you see, the women. If you call one a dog, they're all dogs. But that's really what he was saying. He said, but that's not a bad word when you use it in its proper connotation. You with me so far? Because I have patients who raise dogs, and that's the term they use when I refer to the dog. They say, male or female, what they say, it's a bitch. That's what they would say. And it's a female dog. That's proper. You see? But when you call somebody that name in a derogatory sense, you're misrepresenting the word, and that's what makes it bad. You get my point? Mm-hmm. So, enough of that word, period. We get the point?
I didn't know that.
You didn't know that?
I didn't know.
Well, now you do. You can look in any dictionary, and you'll find that's what it means.
Yeah.
All right? And that's what makes it so bad, because females say, I ain't no doggone dog. You calling me no dog.
Yeah.
Women ain't no doggone dogs. on any level. You see? Now, Romans. Where was I at?
John 6 and 70.
Read it again.
Yahshua answered them, have not I chosen you 12, and one of you is the devil?
Now he said that. Now folks read that and they say, well, let me read that again. You know how you get on the elevator? You know, and you push number 2. And everybody push, there's 3 floors, they're all 3 lights on. Then everybody get on, they look, and they push number 2. You get it, and everybody look, and you see the light, you push. You get the point I'm trying to make? Everybody pushing the doggone lights already pushed. What you pushing it for? You see? And there have been 10 people get on there, and they all push the light after they look at it. Every night, and once see that's pushed, they just get on back to the back. Probably because they couldn't get over there and push. Or, you know, some people don't rewrite and then push it anyway. Like it ain't working, but the light's on. This is what we do. You see? So folks want to read that again. Now this is another one they want to read again. Isaiah 45 and 5. Make it 7, because I ain't got time.
Isaiah 45 and 7. I form the light and create darkness. I make peace and create evil. I, Yahweh, do all these things.
Now, everybody have a problem with that. You want to read that again, too?
Yes.
Go ahead and read it again so nobody has to read it again.
I form the light.
Read.
And create darkness.
Go ahead.
I make peace.
Uh-huh.
And create evil.
Uh-huh.
I, Yahweh, do all these things.
So I, Jesus, do all these things, huh? How about that? You see?
Yeah.
I, Yahweh, do all these things. He's the one that created for his own good pleasure.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Jump over to 46, 9, and 10. Let's move on. Before I make my point.
Remember the former things of old.
Read on.
For I am El.
For I am Elohim. Read on.
And there is none else.
There is none else. Come on, read.
I am Elohim.
Uh-huh.
And there is none like me.
There is none like me. And now, where are you now? I'm Elohim. Where are you? My soul. You don't have a soul. It's his soul. You don't have a body. It's his body. We all came out of that body. We call it you. We got to say something. Got to call you something. This is Yahweh, the personality of Adam. It's Yahweh made manifest as Adam. Come on, man. He created his own body and then he got in him. Adam don't know nothing just like you don't know nothing. But it's Yahweh in you revealing himself to you. If that be the case, Job will be in Job trying to reveal himself to Job. And let me tell you something. Sometimes Job don't know who the heck he is. You know how we are. We got to go talk to somebody. For what? You already know who you are and what you are and why you're doing it. You just don't want to believe it. Well, she left me. Well, what she do that for? I don't know. Come on. Everybody know why she left. Come on. No man leaves a good woman. No woman leaves a good man. Isn't that right? Unless something's up.
Right.
And something's always up. But we ain't going to get into that tonight. That's another story. Read.
Declaring the end from the beginning.
Read on.
And from ancient times, the things that are not yet done.
So Yahweh declared the end right from the beginning. Go ahead.
Saying, my counsel shall stand.
Whatever I purpose, whatever I declare, it shall come to pass. Come on.
And I will do all my pleasure.
Whatever I purpose. Read on.
Calling the eagle from the east.
Go ahead.
The man that executed my counsel from a far country.
Read.
Yea, I have spoken it.
Uh-huh.
I will also bring it to pass.
Read.
I have purposed it.
Uh-huh.
I will also do it.
Now that's Yahweh. He's going to do whatever he purposed and declare within the realm of eternity. Now, in order for him to reveal himself to the man, he had to come down out of this state into an incorporeal state and into the flesh. You see? So what he does, he calls Moses up in the mountain. You see? And he blacks him out. You see? Pick up Exodus 24:19 and just start reading. He blacks him out. You see? And then, the one that invites him up is back here with Moses, whom the world called Jesus Christ. He was back here in the flesh. Joshua the son of Nun invites him up, talking about Moses in the mount, and he shows him the spirit and body. He transformed into the threefold completely from his tabernacle and instructs Moses to have him build one down here in the mountain. In the wilderness, just exactly like the one he saw in the mountain. Now this tabernacle have a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about, which lines up to your physical body. Your head region lines up to the most holy place. Your chest region lines up to the holy place. And your court roundabout, or your abdominal region, lines up to the court roundabout. It has the most holy place, and the court roundabout. The man is made spirit, soul, and body, or he have a head cavity, a chest cavity, an abdominal cavity. Or a head region, a chest region, an abdominal region. But he's one man, just like we got one tabernacle. There's nine furnishings in this tabernacle, you see. And as you're coming into the gate, or into the tabernacle, the altar, you see, is two, whereas the gate is one. The gate is one, the altar is two. The laver where the washing takes place is three. The cup of holy anointing oil is at the door, which is number four, which is your second department of veil, which is blue, purple, and scarlet. The second part, the first department of veil separates the court roundabout from the holy place. The second departmental veil is your sixth step in your pattern. It separates the most holy place from the court roundabout, from the holy place. Blue, purple, and scarlet, blue, purple, and scarlet. You see? And as you're coming on in here, you got these articles. You got the seven brass golden lampstand, which is for light. You got the table of shoe bread, which is responsible for the sustenance that the high priest would take up. And then, of course, you have the altar of incense, you see, which was a sweet-smelling savor, you see, or incense that would walk up into the most holy place, you see, to prevent Yahweh from smelling the stench of these animals that were being sacrificed out here on this altar. Nevertheless, there's nine furnishings, you see, three in the court roundabout,
three in the holy place, and this is the three-in-one configuration of pure beaten gold. You have the mercy seat, you got Michael and Gabriel. Michael's the warrior, Gabriel the messenger. And you got Yahweh, who is sitting on the mercy seat. And there is a cover, or a leaf-like cover, that covers up the mercy seat. And inside the mercy seat is Aaron's rod, the butter, a pot of manna, and the two tables of stone. Y'all with me so far? That is your tabernacle pattern. Now, you are a replica of this pattern right here. That's why we got it here. Man made in the image of Elohim, that is by the pattern of the tabernacle. Now, Yahweh Elohim is the true original pattern, you see? And he had to transform into this three-flow, completely furnished tabernacle as he showed Moses who he is. This is an explanation or a definition of the shape and form. So we have anatomy, but we also have physiology. You see, we have anatomy, which is structure, but there's also a priesthood who's functioning in and out of the tabernacle. Just like in each one of your systems, you see, there is anatomy and there's a physiological function within the system, the nervous system, the endocrine system, the reproductive system, making up a triad, you see. And then you, over here, you have the respiratory system, which points to your lungs, your circulatory system, which points to your heart, and your excretory system, of course, which points to your kidneys. And coming on down, you have your digestive tract, which is the foundation of the man's body, you see. And then it's flanked by, of course, your skeletal system and, of course, your muscular system. You with me so far? So there's nine systems in the man's body. You understand? Why? Because there's nine vessels in this tabernacle. This physical body that you wear is considered an earthen vessel, correct?
Right.
Right? So therefore, when Yahweh made the earth, you with me so far? He put nine planets in your galaxy or in your solar system to point to the nine principal attributes, to point to the nine systems in the man. So he made a tabernacle, of course, with nine vessels. That ain't no coincidence. You with me so far? So now when you look at the man, you see, you got, when you look at the pattern, it starts from the hand down. A lot of times we start from the bottom up, but it's from the hand down. So when you go over here and you line this up here, you see, to the head region, you got the mercy seat. You got the two archangels, and they're looking right at Yahweh, not at each other. You see? They're looking at the one Yahweh, or the one spirit that's in the midst of this cloud right here. Because see, after he built the tabernacle, it was Yahweh who came in and filled the house, and he sat on top of this mercy seat, you see, which is Yahweh chose to symbolize himself as a cloud. So therefore, your brain is made up of gray and white matter, just like a cloud is made up of gray and white matter. But in the midst of the cloud, there is a man in the midst of your cloud. From a physiological standpoint, or from a structural standpoint, we have what we call an arterial circle of Willis, you see, which is a appears to be a stick figure of a man that is in your brain to show you or to prove to you being a witness that Yahweh is in the midst of your consciousness or he's in the midst of your body. Mm-hmm. And the reason why you move and have your being is because you're being governed by spirit law. And that's this arterial circle of Willis is a witness there's a man in the midst of your body.
Right.
Why? Because Yahweh, you see, is the one who is sitting, you see, on the mercy seat. And the high priest, when he performed the service properly, you see, the flash of the Shekinah, or the Shekinah, or the Shekinah, as they say in the South, you see, it flashed to show that the service, you see, was done properly. And when Yahweh reveals something to you, you say, oh, God, I see that. That's the flash of the Shekinah, or the Shekinah, within your consciousness. Now, Michael the warrior, Gabriel the messenger, you see. Now, in your brain, you have a motor function, which is likened to Michael, but you also have a sensory function, where the sending and receiving of messages,
which is likened unto Gabriel. When Yahweh sent a message, he sent Gabriel. When he wants somebody to go kick some butt, he sent Michael. So you have a motor function, action. You also have a sensory function, that's Gabriel. And you have Yahweh in the midst of the cloud, governing everything. Now, as you're coming on out, you see, at the base here of the mercy seat, this is one pure beat piece. This lines up with your pituitary gland, where you have three hormones on one side, on the anterior lobe, and you have seven on the other. You see, and your hormones, you see, and your body, like what we got law here, you see, this is the master gland at the base of the brain. You see, there's a pit, you see, and there's a cover that covers over that doggone pituitary gland. What that pituitary gland said, what you're going to have, a big head or a little eye, big head, little head, blue eyes, green eye, you're that black hair, blonde hair, brunette, that's what the pituitary gland does. It's the master gland of your body, and it governs your body. Well, that law, you see, was in the Ark of the Covenant, and that law, it governed Israel. They had to be obedient, you see, to the law that Yahweh gave them. But there was 10 laws written on the table of stone. It's not like the movie, five on one side and five on the other. Lining up here. Now, you have your second departmental veil, which is blue, purple, and scarlet, which of course lines up to your neck region. Now, your neck separates your chest region from your head. You with me so far? So therefore, this second departmental veil separates the most holy place from the most holy place from the holy place. And in your neck region is the greatest concentration of arteries and veins and capillaries in this neck region. And that's why they say go for the jugular, right? Because you're going to bleed like a pig. So in your body, you have what we call arterial blood, which points to the scarlet or the red blood, which we call oxygenated blood. You see, and then you got the blue blood, which we call venous blood, where it's deoxygenated, meaning it looks blue. And some people, when you have a lack of oxygen, you begin to turn blue, we call being cyanotic, if you will. You see, and so what happened when you're depleted of oxygen, you look blue. You see, and in your in the next region, you have a thyroid gland, you see. You got two lobes on each side, you see. Mm-hmm. But the point I'm trying to get you to see, your thyroid gland, which secretes thyroxin, also has iodine. And iodine is purple in color. So the veil is blue, purple, and scarlet. So as we come on into, of course, the holy place, we got three more vessels. We got the altar of incense, you see. And this is the five-sided structure because your lungs have five lobes. You see, and we call it the tracheobronchial tree because when you look at the trachea or the bronchus, you see how it branch off looking like a tree or like grapes. You see, I'm talking about depleted grapes. But on the ends of these, what we call alveoli, you got the bronchus, you got the main stem, it branches off and branches off and branches off. And at the end, you have a grape-like structure, what we call alveoli, where gas exchange takes place, of course, in your lungs. You with me so far? Air comes in, you see, and your lungs expand like that, right? So likewise, you see, in your pattern here, you see, this veil here, which is actually the door, is curtains. They move. As the wind blows, the trees move, right? Likewise, as the wind blows, these curtains move. And you can see movement in there, you see. But this is blue, purple, and scarlet, you see. Nevertheless, your lungs, you see, points to this altar of incense. Now, there's only four ingredients in the air, right? There's hydrogen, nitrogen, CO2, and carbon dioxide. Those are only four ingredients in the air. No man knows the composition of the air. But don't think they're not trying to find out, because they got to sell it. Nevertheless, there's four ingredients. Only the high priest knew the composition or the four ingredients to make up the incense that would walk up or perfume this tabernacle. So Yahweh would not smell the stench of these animals, you see, burning down here, you see. But it was frankincense, galbanum, onycha, and stactes. Those are the four ingredients. But only the high priest knew the composition to make it up, you see. But that's your lungs right here. And also, you have what they call cornus, you see, because there was four horns. There's four horns, you see, on your trachea, at the base of your trachea, called carnus. You see, that was on the top, you see, of your trachea here. But the point I'm trying to get you to see, your tracheobronchial tree lines up to your lungs or your respiratory system. Coming on over here, you see, you got the cerebral vascular left hand, you got the tabular shewbread. The tabular shewbread lines up to your four-chambered heart. You got a right and left auricle, you got a right and left ventricle. You follow me? And this is a cross-section so you can see exactly what's going on within the heart. You see, and actually, I ain't gonna get into that, but actually your heart is actually all together. You don't have the aorta over here and your heart over here. But this is painted like this so you can see, you see, the illustration of what's actually going on. But to make a long story short, you see, it's four-chambered heart, you see, and this four-chambered heart lies up to the tabular shewbread. It's a four-sided structure. And there's a crown that goes around it because you have a coronary that goes around the heart that feeds the heart. You with me so far? Likewise, you see, you got rings and valves, you see, or rings and valves in your heart here for the opening and the closing of the valves to allow the blood to come in and to prevent it from coming in. You know what I'm saying? On a cadence or rhythm. What happened to this thing? You see? It's the pumping of the blood. So the point is you got rings and valves here. Likewise, you have rings here. You see, or that coronary. And what they would do, they would take the stain, they would put it in because they couldn't trust the artery. They would pick it up and it would move when it's time to break it down and move it. So, you got 12 loaves of bread, you see, on your tabular shewbread. You see, 12 loaves on one side and 12 on the other side, pointing to the right and the left side of the heart. You got the left side of the heart, which is actually where the biggest muscular portion of the heart. And then you got the right side of the heart, where you have your sinus rhythm being dictated over here in the right side of the heart, right here. Nevertheless, you see, that is what that is made of, why it's laid out like that. 12 tribes of Israel, the average man had 12 pints of blood in his body. Y'all with me so far? Mm-hmm. Then coming over here, you got the seven branch golden lampstand, you see, which the high priest would snuff it out at 9 o'clock in the morning and dress it. He would put oil in the fourth branch and would fill all the branches evenly, you see, and he would light it at 3 o'clock in the afternoon because it was getting ready for the evening sacrifice, you see. So therefore, the tabernacle could never be dark at any time, and the sunlight would illuminate the tabernacle, but at night the lampstand would burn all night long to 9 o'clock in the morning, and the priest would dress it again and fill it with oil. Follow me. Now that points to your seven branch aortic arch here. Because coming off your seven branch aortic arch, you see, you have seven vessels that pumps oxygenated blood to the systemic portion of your body or to the rest of your body. You see, and what happens is this, you got the innominate artery as it's coming off here. You see, and then coming off that on the right side, you see, you have the right common carotid, you got the subclavian, you see, you got the coronary. And then on the other side, your left side, you got the right and left, you got the left subclavian, the common carotid, and also you have your coronary coming off here because you got to feed the heart. You see, so that's seven, and that innominate, it breaks on off, going down the arm. You follow me? Which we call the brachiocephalic, and it just feeds the heart. You with me so far? So this is the seven branch aortic arch. Pumping oxygenated blood, which is red or scarlet, you see. That's the seven branch golden lampstand. Now, the average man, you see the flickering of a candle? It kind of flickers, right? It's flickering just like your heart as it beats. It flickers blood throughout the body all day and all night. Why? Because see, when your lights go out is when your blood stops flowing. As long as your blood is flowing, whether it's day or night, that means your light's on. That's the light shining in darkness, and the darkness comprehending not. Likewise, it always has to be light. You see, and Yahshua says, I am the light of the world. He says, I'm the bread. He also says, I'm the meaning, or I'll pray the Father for you. You follow me? Now, coming on through here, you have the door here. This door is 3 feet wide. In your body, you have a diaphragm. Your diaphragm, you see,
pushes down. When you breathe, it pushes down in your belly. You see? And your belly pops out as you breathe. But it separates the holy place from the court around the back. And it's 3 centimeters thick in your body. This door is 3 feet wide. Coming on through the door, you see, you have a washing take place, which lines up with your kidneys. Now you now got 2 kidneys, one on either side, you see, and the one on the right side, I believe, it hangs a little bit lower than the left. But to make a long story short, it's about 5 inches apart within the body, you see. Likewise, this is about the cleansing of the blood that takes place in your kidneys. You see, and at the top or the apex of the kidney, you have your adrenal glands, which secretes adrenaline, and that's for the fight or flight syndrome. When you're frightened, all of a sudden you get all this energy, you see, that's the adrenaline flowing, and it's a principle of a quickening that takes place. Because the high priest would pour the cup of holy anointing oil, which was at the door, you see, on his head, and he had only been anointed once in order to officiate in the holy place and the most holy place. Likewise, when your physical body comes in on the earth plane, the spirit takes up residence in your body just once, so you can officiate on the earth plane. You with me so far? So therefore, you see, there's washing to take place. And the high priest would wash himself, but he would also wash his animal. And then there was dirty water. And you know how it is with dirty water, just like your kidneys cleanse. You see, where there is an absorption, there's a distribution, and there's an excretion that's taking place within your kidneys over here. Over here, you see, at the base of the labor, you see, it's likened to your bladder. You got your ureters where the blood or the urine flows into the bladder and out through the spigot. Mm-hmm. Every man walks around, he has, you know, his kidneys filtered the blood or cleanse it, separate the pure blood from the impure blood. And then, of course, you got to urinate. It goes to the base. And then we just let the water down to the spigot. To the spigot down here. Right. Which lines up to, of course, your kidneys. And then you have the altar of incense, which lines up to your digestive tract. Now, they would put the sacrifice on the animal, but they would take the blood of the animal and put it on 4 corners of this altar right here. And they put it on the 4 corners of the altar because this points to the earth, and this respect we're talking about, it points to your digestive tract. In your digestive tract, there's 4 concentrations of arteries and veins. You see, ascending, transverse, descending, and sigmoid colon. You see, now when you put, you see, I would say the sacrifice. I'm talking about the chickens and the cows and the pigs in your body.
Right.
Or whatever you eat, possums, frogs, I don't care. Right. The point is, it goes down, you see, it goes down your food tube, we call it esophagus, you see, and it goes down to your belly. It goes into your small intestines, and then, of course, down into your large intestines, and it finds a place down here that's a vault that houses the stool, you see. But also, it has to also have a passage out, of course, which is your anus, which is the type of the gate that makes any sense. You with me so far? So, my point is, there's 4 concentrations of arteries and veins. There's 4 corners or 4 horns on the altar. This points to the earth. This also points to the water. You see. Now, I said all that to say this. You should be able to see how the man is made in the likeness and image of the Creator. You should be able to see how Yahweh Elohim transformed into this tabernacle to show you, you see, that you are likened to him, or you in his likeness and in his image. So when he formed the man, Moses is a credit for writing the Genesis. But when he looks at Elohim and he sees the man, he was able to write that the man is made in his likeness after his image. You see? So therefore, when Yahweh Elohim takes on shape and form and takes up residence in the man, can't you see how the man is made in the likeness and image of the Creator? It's really just that simple. You see? So now that you got, you see, the man by the pattern, you see, you also got bone structures here. You got pillars. I'll say it like this. The bone structure of a man represents the pillars, the bars, and the bores. Okay? Mm-hmm. Now, the bores would be like your scapula, your shoulder blade, flat bones. You follow me? The bars would be like the bones in your hands, the little tiny bones in your feet and in your hands.
Those are like the bars. Now the pillars are like the long bones, like the femur, the tibia, the fibula, the humerus, you follow me? The radius and the ulna. You see? That. And you got 12 appendages. You got a joint here, a joint here, a joint here. Three. A joint here, a joint here. Shoulder, elbow, wrist. Mm-hmm. On both sides. That's six appendages, right? And then you have the hip bone, the hip joint, the knee joint, and the ankle joint. Mm-hmm. That's another three. And then you got that on both sides. That's 12. You got that? So there's 12 tribes of Israel gathered up. We got it over here. Gathered up around this tabernacle. Three, you see, on the south side, three on the north side, three on the east side, and three on the west side. You see, and what happened when it's time to break down this tabernacle, when that cloud would descend and move, they were told to follow the cloud just like you follow your cloud. So they would break it down, and each 12 tribe, they would wander around the wilderness around here. You see, and when that cloud stopped, that's when they stopped, and they will assemble that tabernacle. But the point I'm trying to make is, a tabernacle is a temporary dwelling place. Mm-hmm. And so, your tabernacle is your head, chest, and abdominal region. You can live without arms and legs. But it's the 12 tribes of Israel, or the arms and legs, that's going to carry this tabernacle around, mm-hmm. just like they carried or moved this one around right. as it wandered around. Mm-hmm. I said all that to say this. The man, we got the tabernacle pattern, we got the tabernacle of man, now we got the man by the pattern. We're showing for structure, we're also showing for function. Anatomy, physiology. We got cause and effect. We got cause and effect. There's nothing within that is not without. There's nothing within that is not without. Yahweh is running the show, and you are a part of that show. What I'm trying to get you to see, that there is not you in Yahweh. It is Yahweh in you as you. And I'm trying to get you to see, it's always been about Him, never about you. We're trying to get you in the body of Yahshua Messiah. And understand this, I'm going to say this again. You think that you are visible, right? And that you're going to become invisible. That's what we think. Right?
Yeah.
But the reality is that you are invisible. And you that must become visible in you. Why? Because you are a threefold universal spirit pattern. With an immutable, unchangeable spirit law operating within you. Mm-hmm. It is not you. Mm-hmm. It is Yahweh in you, as you, and everything you're doing because He is allowing you to do it.
That's right.
If it was left up to you, you wouldn't blink, you forget you have a heart, you forget to go to the bathroom, you get one place, you just have no control. Yahweh is running the whole thing. The reality is that you are what you're looking for. You are what you've been looking for. Stop looking every place for Yahweh. You are, listen, a spiritual being having human experiences, trapped in conditions. You see, you are not a physical being being manifested in the flesh. You are a spirit being. You see, being manifested in the flesh. You see,
right.
But you are a spiritual being having human experiences. That's what the carnal is all about, because you don't know what the spirit is. And once you begin to reveal to you what the spirit is, you'll find out it is these attributes that is manifested in every cosmographical structure of the universe, including you. And then you'll find out that you have this symbiotic relationship with the world. That's why you drink water, because you need water for this earth. That's why you eat the animals, because they'll eat you too. You see, because you gotta have sustenance in this body.
Yeah.
You see, so what I'm trying to get you to see, come to class, read everything. What I don't understand about people is this.
You say he's Yahweh, talking about the founder. You want to poo-poo the Bible, poo-poo the textbook, poo-poo the charts. But I do know this much. Everybody in the front row do some reading. They come in with a Bible, they read their textbook, they read their transcripts, you see? And when I read it, you have a problem with it. When you read it, you don't have a problem with it. You'll pull out a book and read something he quoted to the audience to prove your point. You'll go to the scriptures to prove your point. You'll pull out a transcript to prove your point. Then when I do it, you got a problem. I need the witnesses to check you. To check you about what you say. And this is the one thing the founder said. He says, come to class, be on time, and read everything because you're going to need it. That's what he said in his last lecture. So therefore, don't poo-poo the Bible. Don't poo-poo the textbook. And don't poo-poo the evidence and the witnesses he's left behind. And if you just want to do that, I got a creation to look at to prove the existence of Yahweh. And really, I can't. He proved himself. The right. Vision proves itself. It doesn't need me. Hallelujah.
Okay, thank you. That concludes tonight's lectures. Before I go further, I'm going to have Dr. Eunice Reiser come up and read a part of a letter that was given to Will to give to the class. Okay, this is Paula. Is her last name?
She don't have it doesn't say.
Okay.
It doesn't
Davis.
Have a Davis.
It's Davis? It's off, Joe. Press the button for the headset.
That's
the headset.
Oh, you turned it off.
Yeah. Is Michael
out of
it's
on. It's on. It's cranking on.
Just turn the mic on.
Turn the one.
Yeah. It's up. Push. It's here. Use this.
Yeah.
You. With that.
This is from Paula. When I spoke with the brother Will on August 13th about relocating to Ontario, California to attend and be a member of Ontario IDMR Brent School, I was led to write and reach out in hopes of relocating there. It's so inspiring when I'm struggling or at times seeking an answer or just a vessel to confirm a thought of something spiritual Yahshua has shown me, or simply verification or a question I may be inwardly asking. I'm often led to your class, lectures, or workshops. Over the last 2 years or so, I'm reaching out in faith, hope that the Heavenly Father will open, allow someone's heart, mind, spirit to open up and assist welcoming me in helping relocate there. This is my faith and hope in believing all things are ordained of Yahweh. Hallelujah. Sincerely, peace, Paula.
Okay, thank you for that. Okay, we have classes here Sundays, 11 to 1, Tuesdays and Thursdays, 7:30 and 9:30. All donations can be had by Dr. Eunice Reiser, treasurer. We're going to have a meeting when, Dr. Kenaway?
The 2nd.
September 2nd.
September 2nd. Okay, that'll be 10 o'clock sharp. Okay, let's all stand and be dismissed. And we also have Spanish class there every fourth Sunday of the month. And that is from 9:30 to 10:45. Okay, now unto him, that's able to keep you from falling, present you faultless with his presence, with exceeding joy. To Almighty Elohim, our Savior, to Yahshua Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both for all time, now and ever. Let's all say,
Hallelujah.
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 When is the class? Spanish class? Yeah. What Sunday?
Is this Sunday?
This Sunday.
Yeah.
This one?
Yeah.
This
Sunday. Yeah. It's a fourth Sunday.
There's a whole folder full of them.
Yeah.
When we have more people come on Sunday, they will pass them. Maybe they might know somebody.
I get to bring my coasters from home.